Welcome, everyone. I see so many familiar faces. All right, now I don't, but it's just wonderful to see people that I haven't seen for 30 and 40 years. So this is the Hidden Witness, and we just welcome everyone, especially tonight on this snowy, stormy night. It's a pleasure to see all of you. My name, of course, is Bob Biegel, and my whole family is involved, plus from outside. There's about 15 cast members, a total of 25, that get this production together. If you haven't get a chance to read the synopsis, it'll give you a good overview. We've done four performances of The Hidden Witness in Grand Prairie this past January, and we're thrilled to bring it to Fairview. The children are pumped. On that note, we would like to thank the Dr. Fred Specken Theater and the GPRC for the use of this beautiful facility. Jardin Lorenz, we want to thank you for last night helping us. Marie Korstein, she assisted us in putting this together also. And also I see Roger Opergevich, and he helped pour the concrete in this place. Thank you, Roger. As posted, all donations from tonight's production will be given to three ministries, In the Peace Country, Rising Above, Shining Arrow Ministries, and Rivers of Hope Orphanage. Shining Arrows has an information table in the foyer. Just a few housekeeping rules. Do not record the performance or use flash cameras. If you must be excused during the performance as a courtesy to the performers, please do so during a scene change and not during a scene. There is a 5-gallon bucket of water in the back for cell phones. And there will be a 10-minute intermission following scene 7. The cast and crew would love to hear your feedback and comments after the performance. A box in the foyer to share your feedback is with us. Every person here tonight will have an opportunity to experience through the characters vulnerability, courage, hopelessness, shame, forgiveness. It's a huge one. Forgiveness, fear, and reconciliation. Ladies and gentlemen, I'm proud to present The Hidden Witness.
You've only been sitting there for an hour now, and I'm starving. is next to nothing in this dreadful place. What are you reading anyway?
The Catechism.
Ain't that boring?
No.
Isn't there about 1 hour by now? You must have read about 20 times yesterday. Why do you have to read it?
Because I love it.
Why? What good does it do you?
Well, Sister Margaret told me last Sunday that if I want to become a truly good and obedient girl, then I must go to confession regularly and devote special time each day, prayer and studying the Catechism. I have decided to learn the entire Catechism by heart.
Kate, when you grow up, would you like to become a nun, like Sister Margaret?
Yes, I do, very much.
Kate, I hate Sister Margaret. She's simply vicious.
Oh, Colette, you must not say such awful things. Don't you know it's wrong to speak disrespectfully of her elders, and especially of the Holy Sisters?
Yes, but I don't care.
Colette, look at me. If you too wish to become a good woman when you grow up, then you must start planting the seed in your life now and learn to reverence and respect the authority that God has placed over you.
But I don't love any of the Holy Sisters, nor the priests. They're so cold and stern. At any rate, why ought I to obey those who I can't even love?
Because God says you must.
Then I don't love God either.
Colette!
What? And anyway, I don't think God is really there.
How can you say such horrible things?
Because if he were there, he wouldn't let me go hungry, and he'd give my poor paw back to me.
Oh, Colette, why must you be so defiant? It's impossible to have a civil conversation with you when you insist on shutting down your mouth.
But I'm not shutting you, Kate. I love you. I really do.
Colette, please understand me. All I want to do was what's right. We are all alone in this wide world. We have no mother nor father. But Colette and we do have each other. We are almost like sisters. Now, can you please promise me that you will grow up to be a chaste and obedient woman like I'm trying to be? It would break my heart more than anything else if you left me because you didn't want to be good.
Yes, Kate. I promise I'll try to be a better girl and follow your example. But I'm afraid I may not do as well as you.
Do not compare yourself to me, girl. Only do the best that you are capable of.
Yes, dear. Dinner's cooking. Can you smell it?
Yes, I can. And it smells so good. Kate?
Yes, dear?
I wish I had a papa like other children do.
I know, Colette. I wish I had a papa too. It would be so wonderful.
Kate? Both our mothers are dead, but do you think we'll ever find our birth father someday?
I don't know, but there's one who does know.
Who is that?
God, our Father in heaven.
Won't let anything terrible happen to Mama or the new baby.
You're right, sweetheart, you're right.
Would you like to try some mints Dr. Hall gave me?
No, thank you, sweetheart. But you look tired. Aren't you ready for rest? Aren't you sleepy yet?
Oh, no, Papa. You see, I promised Mama that I would stay up until the baby arrives. And if that means I stay up all night long, then I shall. Just think of it. I'm to be a big sister at last, Papa. I surely won't want to miss the first opportunity to meet my new little baby brother sister.
Of course, sweetheart, of course.
Oh, Ellen, it's the baby! Oh, Papa, come see! Is the girl?
Dr. Hall, what's the matter? How's my wife, Mary?
You have fine
sight. I could see that. How's my wife?
Sorry.
Answer me, Hall.
Please, John. I tried. I tried everything. I couldn't save your wife.
No. God, no. Mary? Oh, Mary.
Mama? Where's Mama?
What's wrong?
Mr. Dallington.
How's my wife, Mary?
You've got a fine son here.
I could see that. How's Mary?
I'm sorry.
Hall, answer me!
I'm sorry, John. I could not save your wife.
No. God, no. Mary? Oh, Mary.
Mama?
Meaningless acts of penance. What of life?
becoming something in that unknown and mysterious world outside these convent walls. To deny myself the pleasure of physical love through the pledge of consecrated virginity is simply too much for me. Kate, what about the possibility of marriage, of having a family, children of one's own? Is this not the purpose of life?
Collette, if we are to become the spouse of Jesus Christ, then we must give up these carnal desires without ever thinking of turning back.
What is the fire that urges you on in this strange and wonderful way? I don't understand you.
It's an overwhelming desire to find acceptance in the heart of God, and to be holy, as He is holy.
But what is the purpose of life if one cannot experience its fascinations? I apologize, Kate, but I do not share your sentiments. My life here is like an empty tomb. There remains but one desire left in my heart, nay, two, and they burn within me like a fire that will not be quenched. Kate, you know this ring was my mother's wedding ring. On her deathbed, she instructed the midwife it was to be mine. When I was a little girl, I made a vow that I would one day search to find my birth father, the man who gave this ring to my mother. Time has only strengthened this desire.
That ring, give it to me.
No, give it to me.
No, not take it from you.
You
told me you gave it up long ago.
I said I did, but I took it back, and I know that I cannot take the first vows of an nun if I insist upon retaining this desire, and I do insist.
And what if your father is dead?
Kate, I myself am dying of hunger, parched with thirst. I'm thirsty for fulfillment, for acceptance, for love itself. In all my life here in this convent, I've never known these things. Would you keep from me the prospect of a life where I might chance to find these things? And tell me what good it is if I die here after giving myself only partially to efforts I feel no calling to fulfill.
Collette, this is only the beginning. Things are sure to become clear to us once we have taken our vows and sealed them with the blood of our own fleshly desires.
It's the very thought of signing away in the vows of poverty, chastity, obedience, every human right causes me to recoil with unparalleled anxiety and dread.
You have lived by the goodness and charity of others all your life, if for nothing more than the obligation you owe to God, then you will take your vow tomorrow.
And it is the call of duty and not of love that you impose upon my unwillingness.
You. Collette, what is it? Tell me!
Kate, all my life you've been like a sister to me, at times a mother. The debt that I owe to you beyond measure, and any good within me is the result of your doing, for my heart was always unbridled and rebellious. But Kate, for the first time in my life, I will act completely against your wishes and not turn back. I've made my decision. I cannot take the vows. I'm leaving.
Collette! No, please! Say you will not leave! Please!
Spare your tears for your penance, Kate. They're wasted if they're shed for me.
Oh, you are cruel! For the love of God, you cannot leave!
But indeed I shall!
Where will you go?
Shall I tell you? Decide to go to Paris.
Paris? Who will go with you? Who will care for you alone and friendless in a world of heartless strangers?
To spend the rest of my life behind convent walls. And worse yet, to be ever fighting against the bit of stern religion in a fruitless effort to subdue my restless nature poses no less a degree of foreboding. Tell me, should the prospect of being surrounded by heartless strangers, as you call them, prove to be anything worse than being surrounded by heartless friends within these walls?
Collette, hold your tongue!
I once told you I hated them. That feeling has not changed.
How did you speak against them after all they've done for you?
Kate? How do you know God is really there? And if he is there, how do I know that he's not a heartless tyrant who demands the obedience of his people without even thinking to consider their own feelings? If he's a God of love, then why can't I feel his love?
You haven't waited long enough yet. Collette, stop listening to the voice of Satan or you will be damned.
You're afraid, aren't you, Kate? You're afraid. You think that by sacrificing your life, your own dreams and pleasures, that you will escape condemnation.
No, no, you misjudge me. It is your rebellion that separates you from the love that Christ desires to show towards you.
How do you know Christ was without sin?
He was the Son of God and the sinless Virgin Mary.
But when the woman was caught in adultery and her accusers prepared to stone her, why did Jesus say, "He who is without sin cast the first stone," and he himself cast not a stone? If he was without sin, he should have cast the very first one. Kate, I need answers, and your resistance only strengthens my resolve. My restless heart refuses to submit to the oppression I feel in this place.
Collette, you promised to stay here in the convent. Can't you please find it in your
Your faith in him is as immovable as you profess, and if you believe that he hears the prayers you make to him daily, then isn't this enough to hold you to your purpose without a minute's hesitation? Even when the only sister you have ever known says that she'll leave you. Kate! Kate! I honestly thought your faith was stronger than this.
You provoke me with your words, but don't you dare mock my faith!
Kate, just remember, no matter how far I go, I will always love you and call you sister.
Sister, call me no more by that sacred and beloved name. I always knew that no matter how hard I tried, you would never understand the things that to me are more important than life. They draw and fascinate my soul from morning until night, and sometimes I cannot even speak, so overwhelmed is my soul with the beauty and the power they inspire within me. Oh, is it possible that I might have attempted to describe in words this wondrous force that can be known only through experience? Oh, I have been a fool. Colette, I will never again call you sister. Tomorrow I enter into an eternal covenant with God and the Holy Roman Church. The vows I swear will forever sever the emotional cords that have bound us to each other. I shall die to you, to myself, to everything I have ever known, and begin a new life of ultimate service and prayer.
Kate, is this what you truly want?
It is what I need!
Then goodbye, Kate.
Won't you please stop running around the house and causing such a dreadful racket?
Papa is in a meeting in his study, and he mustn't be disturbed. Isn't it your bedtime now, Peter?
Oh, but Prissy, I'm not a bit sleepy. Please, won't you let me stay up till night? I'll promise you a card if you'll only let me.
Oh, no, no, you'll be quiet, little Master Dan, even if she doesn't let you stay up till nine. Come along.
Night, Papa.
Oh, Papa! Oh, is something wrong? Who is that man that came to visit you tonight?
We've suffered a terrible defeat at Bull Run. What? 62,000 soldiers engaged, 14,000 casualties. The Confederates only had 50,000 engaged with 8,000 casualties. Now, Peter, my son, Priscilla, sweetheart, both for love of country, and as a loyal citizen, I must leave you. My services at the front are greatly needed as an officer.
But, Papa, surely they could spare you. You are only one man.
Every man in our army heeded such pleading, sweetheart. We wouldn't have a union. Now, I know the intelligence of this is upsetting to you, but you must put on a brave face.
But, Papa, what if you're wounded or killed?
That is a reality that every noble soldier must come to grips with. And as my daughter, so also must you. Enough with this immersion outburst. You must be brave.
Why must these terrible things happen? First Mama dies, and then the war, and he might never return. Why does God, who is a God of love, allow such suffering and a heartache to take place in the world?
Your grandfather always told me that it's only sometimes through suffering and heartache that we can experience the power of God's grace and behold the magnificent unfolding of his mighty and infinite plan.
Papa, how can you know and believe these things?
Oh, sweetheart, the great King of Israel has promised in his word never to fail to show himself strong on behalf of those whose hearts are completely his. Now rest in the shadow of his wings, and all your questions will be answered in his precious time. Peter?
May I go to the war with you, Papa, please?
No, Peter, you're much too young right now. But you can practice being a noble and trustworthy soldier by taking care of your sister while I'm gone. It's a great responsibility.
It is?
Be a woman's strong protector, yes. It's the least a man can do. Do you think you can do it?
I can, Papa, if that's what you want me to do. Does that mean I can sit up till 9 o'clock?
No, Peter, young men like you need to rest. Now, Ellen, I hardly need to ask you to take care of my children while I'm gone.
Mr. Dallington, I would find it a great honor to care for your children. But you must take care of yourself.
Yes. Now, we see no prospect of this war coming to an end anytime soon. Now, I've made arrangements, and it's become far too dangerous for Priscilla and you to stay this close to the line. And I've made arrangements for Peter, Priscilla, and you to stay with my sister Augusta in Paris, in the outskirts of France, until it's safe to come home. No, I'm going to dispatch this letter first thing in the morning and secure 3 passes for your voyage. Helen, thank you for being there. Children, for now, good night. And God bless you.
Good night, Papa.
Enter. Sister dear. Welcome. Please, my child, sit down. I have called you here this morning because I have received word from a military hospital in Washington, D.C. They are in dire need of medical assistance in their efforts to bring aid to the thousands of wounded soldiers fighting in the war, and they have requested that we send a division of our medically trained nursing sisters to assist them. And Sister Kate, you are a well-trained nurse. I know the years prior to your solemn, your final perpetual vows is drawing close to conclusion, and I understand how you desire to take those perpetual vows. Considering all matters, we have decided that you are to sail to the United States and assist in their hospitals, and postpone your vows until you return.
Oh, but dear Reverend Mother, my ceremony. There's no telling how much longer this war could last. Can't you please find someone else to go in my place?
The decision is final. Preparations have been made for your voyage.
Oh, but dear Reverend Mother, I beg you,
Sister Kate, you must learn to submit your self-will to the authority God has placed over you.
Yes, Reverend Mother, then I will go.
Very well, my child. Have you any means?
None that cannot be met through fervent prayers, no remedy through good confession.
In this work of service, you perform a great act of charity and sacrifice. You must rest in the knowledge that you embark upon the work of our blessed Lord. May Jesus, Mary, and Joseph bless and help you.
Purgatory.
Oh, Milton was Protestant, Auntie.
Are you sure?
Oh, yes, of course.
Well, then, very well. You may continue to read it. Breathe! I don't believe in that rubbish they call purgatory. That's all ridiculous.
Aunt Gupta, I saw that the mailman came by today. Did anything come from Papa? I haven't heard from him in 9 days now, and I'm beginning to worry.
Priscilla, I have heard nothing from your Papa.
Oh, dear. What if something has happened? I am so troubled about him.
Well, I can tell you one thing, Missy. You will not be helping matters along by sitting there whining about it.
Excuse me, ma'am. There is a young woman and a little one out on the doorstep.
I let them in. They're wondering if you'd be so kind as to allow them room by your own fire.
But who did you say?
Ma'am, it's a poor young woman and her little one. They were out on the doorstep, freezing in the bitter cold.
Well, then don't just stand there wringing your hands. Show them in. Really?
Right this way. Katie!
You are warmly welcome here, Mademoiselle. My name is Priscilla.
Oh, I'm so sorry. I thought you were someone else.
Please, would you care to take a seat?
May I just warm by the fire?
Oh, yes, of course.
May I see? Come.
Are you sure you don't want to sit down? We do have chairs in case you didn't notice it.
No, I cannot stay long.
Well, then perhaps something to eat, eh? The young boy looks half starved. Do you even feed him? Perhaps some warm milk with honey? Hmm?
Yes, that would be wonderful.
Bon, très bon. Ellen, the milk would get here quicker if you put it in the cup and carry it in. Priscilla, sit down. And for heaven's sake, child, quit wringing your hands in that ridiculous fashion.
Priscilla!
Well, and now you would think someone is being murdered from that look on your face.
Here you are, ma'am. I'll give this to your little one and little warm and right back. Merci, madame. You're very kind.
By the way, madame, what is your name? And what emergency brings you to my doorstep on this cold winter's night?
I'm running away.
Oh? And where on this cold winter's night, might I ask, are you running to?
I cannot say for certain, but it must be somewhere very far away from here. America, perhaps.
Les États-Unis? You mean to tell me it is the United States of America?
Yes.
That would be a pretty sight. I can tell you that you would be risking your life and that of the young one here if you go rushing off into that mess of gunfire and cannonballs.
I'd be doing just the same if I were to remain here.
Just who are you running from, madame?
My employer in Paris.
Your employer? That is a strange one. Just what did madame do to you?
He was a monsieur, a gentleman.
Ah, je comprends. You have a grievance against the male authority. That much I can understand.
He is threatened to murder his own son. My son.
And he was your husband too, of course.
He was not.
Help me to understand this, mademoiselle, whatever your name is. You are telling to me that you had a dalliance with your employer, and from that comes the child. And now you are running away from him because he threatened to kill his own son? That's a good one, I have never heard such a thing.
And Gustav, that is enough. No, it's fine. I know it's immoral, it's all my fault. I should never have listened to him. I should be going now. Thank you for the milk.
Priscilla, what is a telegram from the Washington Hospital? It might be Papa. Oh, Papa's been wounded.
He's at the Washington Hospital. I must go to him at once.
Pardon, what did you say? You are running to America?
Papa's at the hospital. I must go to him at once.
Don't panic so much. That is the most ridiculous thing you could be doing.
Yes, Augusta, there's no time to lose. I must leave immediately on the first available ship.
Ship Polska, no, absolutely not. That would be nothing short of an act of sheer lunacy.
Yes, Augusta, I am not staying here.
Priscilla, wait. Oh! Priscilla, are you sure so concerned? Who is going to pay for this grand voyage? And who will accompany you? A fine, attractive, single, lovely young woman like yourself, but traveling alone to that war-torn country? You could wind up dead.
I will go with her.
You
hope? I have money enough to pay for the voyage fare for both my son and myself. And it is settled. The two of us with your little boy will leave tomorrow on the first ship sailing to America.
You yes. cannot go with this charlatan.
And is it sure that my trunk is packed? And, excuse me, what is your name?
Collette. My name is Collette Clayton.
Yes. Please pack extra things for Mademoiselle Clayton. Quickly now.
Well, if nobody wants some my advice, I might as well just sit here with my mouth shut. But Priscilla, just who is going to fund your wild goose chase? I cannot even pretend to know.
I will pay for my own fare across the ocean with the money that Papa sent to me in his last letter. So you need not worry yourself on that account, Ed.
I never could figure out that girl. Or her papa, my good-for-nothing brother. So what is to become of them? I cannot even think it. I get a funny feeling in my thumbs whenever something strange is about to happen. And I'm feeling it now. But Rufus, oh, you poor thing, no wonder you cry. You have not had your cream yet. I would cry too. I sent Peter over an hour ago to get that. I don't know what could be keeping him. Peter? Peter, where are you? Fairy, what is this? I sent you to get a dish of ice cream, not an entire gallon.
Oh, but Auntie, I just thought that if I fetched a gallon of cream now, I wouldn't have to go and fetch a second helping later.
Ephron, you sassy child. This fat cat could not even get half that amount of cream into his belly. Now get it back to the larder before I box your ears. Run, I am after you.
This man needs much care. I fear that this gangrene is spreading at a rapid pace. He is fortunate, though. I heard he's one of the few men spared death from imprisonment by the rebels. What do you think, Sister Kate? All right, then. Wrap that up, we'll clean it up later. He's overheating. It's just the thing for that. Sister Kate, remember to check up on the patient regularly tonight. And keep the arm in the same position. Wouldn't want to disturb that wound dressing.
Yes, sir.
We'll need to operate in order to clean up the remaining shrapnel, okay, agree?
Do you still think that amputation will be necessary, Doctor?
You may need to amputate. If that infection spreads, though, it will become fatal. But I'll decide that when I return in a couple hours. Until then, pull a spoonful of this every half hour. And cheer up. Here, have a peppermint. Oh, well, little one for me. Oh, sister, besides, it comes by itself, doesn't it? Oh, John, stick around. I'll be back. Right, clock.
Medicine.
yourself?
Inside my coat, there's a miniature of my daughter. Love upon it.
This must be the one?
Yes, please. Oh, Miss Ella. She's so beautiful. She's my pride and joy. What's going to happen to me?
Please try not to worry about it now, sir. Just try to rest. I'll put away the picture.
Don't lose it.
It's right back in the pocket.
Sister Kate, my past. It just haunts me. You don't believe me. It keeps coming back. You suppose I should do it?
Why, sir, you must send for a priest and confess your sins to him in order that he might grant you absolution and prescribe the true and just penance. The Epistle of St. James says that we are to confess our sins to one another and pray for one another, that we may be healed.
And in that case, the priest would have to confess his wrongs to me. Some water, please. Oh, thank you.
You feeling all right now?
Much better, thank you. You're so kind.
Please just try to rest, sir. Yes, what is it?
Sister Kate, there's a young lady here to see Lieutenant Dowington.
Oh, well, the patient is resting right now. He should not be disturbed. Whoever it is, they can call another time.
The young lady says she's his daughter. She received a telegram and is most anxious to see the patient. I wonder, is he well enough to see her?
It's his daughter?
Yes, she says her name is Priscilla Dallington. She's also come with another young woman and a child. I'll show them in.
Oh, no, but yes, the doctor did say that he isn't to be disturbed. Very well.
Chance of fate has thrown us together in such a horrible place as this. Sickness, mourning, death. Ah, yes. How faithfully it mirrors the condition of my heart. We see each other again after 5 long years. She hasn't changed. I knew she wouldn't. I'm the one who's so changed. With a curse, the mark of the world is branded upon my forehead. Surely I shouldn't question the reason for the reproach, the condemnation I feel in her presence. Still, I will not give up. Priscilla? Sorry, there's something I must ask you.
Yes, what is it, Colette?
Would you be willing to help care for William if I were to offer my services here at the hospital? I have money and will pay you well.
Yes, of course. It would be a joy for me to care for William, Colette.
But I would not do it for money.
Colette, you seem so troubled.
Oh, I'm fine. It's just coming to this place brings back many memories of my past life.
Oh.
Thank you, Priscilla, for your kindness and for everything you've done for my son and I. I'm truly grateful.
Ladies, Sister Kate has left clear instructions that this patient must be left alone now. Come on, this way, please.
Yes, one moment, please.
Very well, be quick.
Papa, I must go now.
Of course, sweetheart, goodbye. And God be with you.
God bless you, Papa.
Needs a lot of care. The gangrene is spreading rapidly up his arm. He's fortunate, but I understand that he's one of a few of his battalion that was spared death or captured by those blasted rebels. What do you think, sister? Oh, this man's burning up. Make sure his arm stays in this position and, make sure he doesn't move his wound dressing.
Yes, doctor.
We'll have to do surgery soon in order to remove the remaining gangrene and the remaining shrapnel.
Do you still think that amputation will be necessary, doctor?
Aye, lass, we may have to amputate his arm. If the infection spreads any further, it'll be done for. But I will determine that when I return in a couple of hours. Make sure that the instruments are all ready. But until then, give him every half hour a spoonful of this medicine.
Yes, doctor.
But cheer up, sister. Here, have a peppermint. Well, one more for me. The sourness kind of comes by itself now, doesn't it? Hang in there, John. I'll be back at 8 o'clock.
Hail Mary, full of grace, the Lord is with thee. Blessed art thou among women, and blessed is the fruit of thy womb, Jesus. Holy Mary, Mother of God, pray for sinners now.
Sir, my daughter, is that you?
No, sir, I'm not your daughter. It's all right, the fever has just upset you. Please try to rest. Full of grace, the Lord is with thee. Blessed art thou among women, and blessed is the fruit of thy womb, Jesus. Holy Mary.
Percy, could that be you?
My name is Sister Kate. Fever is very high.
It was just that you remind me so much of my daughter. Have I seen you before?
I never saw you before you first came to the hospital, sir. Here, please sit up. Take this medicine. Oh, please, sir. Please, stay still. Well, how can I help you?
Please, inside my uniform jacket, in the left side, there's a miniature of my daughter. Would you please get it out for me?
This one?
Yes. Open it. Oh, Priscilla. She's so beautiful. Oh, she's my pride and joy. Oh. What's gonna happen to me?
Don't worry about it now, sir. Just please try to rest. Everything will be fine here. Can I put away the picture?
Please, don't lose it.
It's right back in your pocket, sir.
Thank you. Oh, my past, Sister Kate. It haunts me. It's relentless. It will leave me. What do you suppose I should do?
Why, sir, you must send for a priest and confess your sins to him, in order that he might grant you absolution and prescribe the true and just penance. The Epistle of St. James says that we are to confess our sins to one another and pray for one another that we may be healed.
Well, in that case, the priest would have to confess his wrongs to me.
Sit up. Are you feeling all right?
Oh, yeah, much better, thank you.
Please.
You're far too kind.
Please just try to rest. Yes, what is it?
Sister Kate, there's a young lady here to see Lieutenant Dallington.
The lieutenant is resting right now. He should not be disturbed. Whoever it is, I'm sure they can call another time.
The young lady says she's his daughter. She's come from France and is most anxious to see the patient. I wonder, is he well enough to see her?
It's his daughter?
Yes, she says her name is Priscilla Dallington. She did receive the telegram and is most anxious to see him. There's another young woman and child that have come with Miss Dallington, and I will show them in.
But please, the doctor did say that he isn't to be disturbed. Very well. Papa, I'm here.
Priscilla, is that really you?
Yes, Papa, I received a telegram and Aunt Gus says it said that you were severely wounded. I was so worried. I came as quickly as I could.
Oh, sweetheart, I have missed you so much.
Oh, Papa, I missed you too, but how are you injured? What is it? Dreadful smell.
It's just an infection. It's just gangrene. It'll be fine.
Just gangrene?
It's all right, Priscilla. Don't worry, you. Please, where's Peter?
Back in France with Aunt Augusta. He and Ellie will travel home as soon as we send word.
Of course.
How long has he been out of your care? 2 weeks, miss. But it was 4 or 5 days after the wounding when the ambulance finally brought him from the field hospital to Washington. It is his arm that was wounded. Do you know how it happened? A piece of...
Please, tell me everything that you know.
A piece of shrapnel lodged in his left upper arm. I heard that it was only because of the courage of one of his comrades who lifted him from the battlefield and in the midst of action brought him to safety that he narrowly escaped being blown away by cannon fire. However, the wound wasn't treated in time and infection set in.
They won't need to amputate it, will they?
Well, if the infection cannot be cleaned out entirely, I'm afraid Dr. Hall has prescribed it to be the last option. Well, that is if the lieutenant is to be saved from gangrene poisoning.
Do you know when the doctor will operate?
Tonight.
Dear God, why did he have to leave us? Why did he?
of these terrible things that happened to my own dear Papa.
It's all right, Priscilla. You can be grateful he's not dead.
Oh, Papa.
Priscilla, enough. Benita must lose my arm. It's small in comparison to life itself.
Papa, I aren't you bad? I thought of them hacking off your arm.
Priscilla, you know it won't kill me. Now that is enough. I presume you've met Sister Kate. Sister Kate, this is my daughter, Priscilla.
Yes, I'm very pleased to meet you, Miss Allington.
She seems sweet enough, Papa, but somehow very peculiar.
Good sweetheart, she is. Who's the young lady with the boy?
Well, that's Colette and William. William! William, come. Meet my Papa.
Hello, William. It's good to meet you.
That woman. Oh, could it be, my dear sister? Kate? Oh,
what freak chance of fate has thrown us together in such a horrible place as this? Sickness, mourning, death.
Ah, yes. How faithfully it mirrors the condition of my heart. We see each other again after 5 long years. She hasn't changed. I knew she wouldn't. I'm the one who's so changed. Like a curse, the mark of the world is branded upon my forehead. Surely I shouldn't question the reason for the reproach, the condemnation I feel in her presence. Still, I will not give up. I know what I must do. Priscilla, there's something I must ask you.
What is it, Colette?
Would you be willing to help care for William if I were to offer my services here at the hospital?
Oh, yes.
I have money and will pay you well.
Oh, Colette, it would be a joy for me to care for William, but I would not do it for money.
Colette, you seem so troubled. No, I'm fine. It's just, coming to this place brings back many memories of my past life. Thank you, Priscilla, for your kindness, for everything you've done for my son and I.
Please excuse me, ladies, but Sister Kate has given clear instructions of this patient. He must be left alone now, as he will need sufficient rest before Dr. Hall performs the operation. Please, this way.
Yes, one moment, please.
Very well, be quick.
Papa, I must be going now.
Of course, goodbye, and God bless you.
God bless you. Colette, why did you have to come back? After all the years of fighting to banish your memory from my mind, you come back. Why? To destroy me. But if you thought you could change me, you're wrong. You're wrong, I tell you. I have severed every human attachment, every dream, every desire, every foolish hope. I have buried your acts of service and sacrifice. See? My duty stands before me, and God forbid that I should ever leave it.
Oh, hey, John, this time.
I'm ready.
Sister Kate, hand me that bottle of chloroform.
Yes, Doctor.
All right, John, lift your head and breathe deep. Okay, relax. Scalpel, Mike. And ensure that the application saw and the tenaculum are ready in case we require them.
Yes, Doctor.
Sister Bernice.
Yes, Doctor.
Please record the time and the date of Lieutenant John Dallington's surgery.
Of course.
Sister Kate, hold here. And hold here. Steady now.
Sorry, Doctor.
to you. Well, I feel my strength coming back to me. How are you this morning, Sister Katie?
I'm fine, sir.
Good. I feel my strength coming back again. And I'll be a happy man indeed to be home with my children.
Is there anything that I can get for you, sir?
No, I'm quite fine, thank you.
Well, if you require further assistance, please send for Sister Bernice. I will be assisting the doctor down the corridor.
Actually, I'd like to get back to our conversation about confession. That is, of course, if you have the time.
Well, I will do my best to answer your question, sir.
What makes you so certain that the priest has the authority to grant absolution of sin?
Well, early writers of the faith have clearly stated that confessions must be made for a priest. Cyprian said that only through a priest may forgiveness be obtained. Ambrose further stated that this right to forgive sins is given to priests only, because Christ cannot be with us in the flesh, we require a representative of him in order to make a proper confession.
Well, is this only an attempt to justify the nullification of the sovereignty of God's grace through the sacrifice of his Son?
I'm afraid you misunderstand me, sir. The power of Christ to forgive sins was transferred to men when Jesus breathed on his disciples and said, "Receive ye the Holy Ghost. Whosoever sins you remit, they are remitted, and whosoever sins you retain, they are retained." We interpret these passages to mean that God gave to other men of the church the same power to forgive sins that Christ exercised while he walked with them.
Yet it was Christ, not the priest, that died and rose again. Christ alone is identified as the intercessor between God and man. If we believe this, what's the need for another man to intercede for us?
The priest has separated himself exclusively to the service of God and the church through a celibate life. He is therefore qualified to become the physical representative of our Lord and to hear the confessions of his children.
Do you believe God to be a personal or an impersonal being?
Mr. Dallington, I should think it quite obvious that I consider Christ to be a personal savior.
Well, then why do you maintain the necessity of a physical representative of him? Isn't that a contradiction?
I said that the hearing of the priest assures us that our sins have been properly confessed and forgiven, sir.
Then what is the need and purpose of Christ?
Excuse me, sir, but are you truly a penitent sinner who wishes me to send for a priest, or do you merely think to take sport by interrogating me with your questions?
You'll have to excuse my bluntness, but whose blood was shed, Christ's or the priest's? I simply cannot reconcile your dogma with plain scripture.
Which proves the need for an interpreter of the scriptures in order that we might maintain consistency in our traditions and our profession of faith.
But again, if God is a personal being, then why would he intend men to institute interpreters of his infallible word when Christ said that he was the way, the truth, and the life, and that no man may come to the Father except through him?
Flatter yourself, you may, sir, to thinking that you will win this argument, but before we conclude, can you prove that your own doctrine is flawless and your dogma consistent? Can you account for the many different denominations of your own faith?
I'm not saying that mine is entirely faultless, but I will maintain that if I elevate my religious practices above my love for him and his word, well, then the essence of those practices become nothing more than, well, climbing grass and tinkling cymbals.
Do you mean to tell me, sir, that to you I sound like nothing more than plain brass?
I'm merely saying that the justification for your dogma might.
Why?
Morning, John.
Good morning, Dr. Holman.
How are you feeling?
I'm feeling very well, thank you.
Well, I'm glad to see that your eloquent self is getting back to you, my friend.
Well, it's getting back to most of you.
How's the food?
Well, highly suspect.
It looks cold.
Well, looks cold.
Between me and you, I'm sure these peppermints have a little more nutrients than what you're getting.
You're a good man. But I have one for breakfast. It's not looking good.
Man after my own heart. Running short.
Thank you. Don't tell her, eh?
Oh, don't worry. They're sweets. Some just love it. I must agree, John. Laughter is the best medicine of all.
It is.
Well, should we get down to business?
If you would, please.
Right then. Other than that, this is healing fine. And you, my friend, You can expect to be sitting in front of your own hearth with your children around you by next week. With both your eyes. Breathing that.
Thank you all.
Sister Grace, I'd like you to follow me. I'd like to give you further instruction in a patient in the adjacent ward. Oh, John! Be sure to drink plenty of water.
Here's your breakfast, sir.
Good morning to you, Sister King. Well, I'm feeling better, thank you. How are you this morning?
Fine.
Well, I must say, I feel my strength returning to me even now. I'll be a happy man indeed to be home with my children.
Is there anything that I can get for you, sir?
No, I'm quite fine. Thank you very much.
If you require further assistance, please send for Sister Bernice. I will be assisting the doctor down the corridor.
Well, actually, I'd like to get back to our conversation regarding confession. That is, of course, if you have the time.
Why, yes, of course. I will do my best to answer any of your questions.
Well, what makes you so certain that the priest has the authority to grant absolution of sin?
Early writers of the faith have clearly stated that confessions must be made to a priest. Cyprian said that only through a priest may forgiveness be obtained. Ambrose further stated that this right to forgive sins is given to priests only. Because Christ cannot be with us in the flesh, we require a representative of him in order to make a proper confession.
But is this just a justification of the nullification of the sovereignty of God's grace through the sacrifice of his Son?
I'm afraid you misunderstand me, sir. The power of Christ to forgive sins was transferred to men when Jesus breathed on his disciples and said, "Receive ye the Holy Ghost. Whosoever sins you remit, they are remitted, and whosoever sins you retain, they are retained." We interpret these passages to mean that God gave to other men of the church the same power to forgive sins that Christ exercised while he walked with them.
Yet it was Christ, not the priest, who died on the cross and rose again. Christ alone is identified as the intercessor between God and man. Well, if we believe this, then what need is there for another man to intercede for us?
The priest has separated himself exclusively to the service of God and the church through a celibate life. He is therefore qualified to become the physical representative of our Lord and to hear the confessions of his children.
Well, do you believe God to be a personal or an impersonal being?
Mr. Dallington, I should think it quite obvious that I consider Christ to be a personal savior.
Then why do you maintain the necessity of a physical representative of him? Isn't that a contradiction?
The hearing of the priest assures us that our sins have been properly confessed and forgiven.
Well, then what is the purpose and necessity of Christ?
Excuse me, sir, but are you a truly penitent sinner who wishes me to send for a priest? Or do you merely think to take sport by interrogating me with your question?
Listen, forgive my bluntness, Sister Kate. But whose blood was shed, Christ's or the priest's? I simply can't reconcile your dogma with plain scripture.
Which proves the need for an interpreter of the scriptures in order that we might maintain consistency in our traditions and our profession of faith.
But again, if God is a personal being, then why would he intend men to institute interpreters of his infallible word when Christ himself said that he was the way, the truth, and the life, and that no man may come unto the Father except through him?
Flatter yourself, you may, sir, into thinking that you will win this argument, but before we conclude, can you prove that your own doctrine is flawless and your dogma consistent? Can you account for the many different denominations of your own faith?
No, I'm not saying that mine is entirely faultless. But I will maintain that if I elevate my religious practices above my love for God and his word, well, then the essence of those religious practices become, well, nothing more than clanging brass and tinkling cymbals.
Do you mean to tell me, sir, that to you I sound like nothing more than clanging brass?
No, I'm merely pointing out that the justification for your dogma might.
Why?
Good morning, Dr. John.
Good morning, Doctor.
Glad to see that your eloquent self has returned to you.
Well, back to most of me.
How's the food?
Incredibly suspect.
It looks rather cold. Here, have a peppermint.
Thank you.
I guarantee you it's better for you than whatever's in there.
Do you know she wanted me to eat that?
Oh.
Well, can I have another one for breakfast?
And they are sweet. The sourness just left.
Don't tell her anything.
Ah, 'tis been a grand day.
Mm-hmm.
Well, Shall we get down to business?
Oh, if you would.
Alrighty then. See how this incision is healing up here. We've got a wee bit of swelling right here.
You see? Well, you see now.
A little touchy, aren't we?
Just a little.
Sister Bernice, make sure that his arm stays elevated and apply full compress as required.
Of course.
Well, my friend, you can expect to be sitting before your own hearth, with your wee children all around you. I say the end of the week. With both your arms, how do you feel about that?
Thank you very much, Hall. You're a good man.
Sister Bernice, follow me. I've got some instructions for you regarding another patient in an adjacent ward. Oh, and John, drink lots of water.
Only she desired perfection, while I yearned for freedom. Her dream was to become a nun, but I couldn't give up my childhood dream of one day finding my birth father. This was my mother's wedding ring. On her deathbed, she instructed the midwife it was to be mine. It's been my talisman. Together, Kate and I completed our 2-year novitiate, but I had grown to hate religion. I hated the church, I hated the nuns, I hated the priests, and I despised myself. I contemplated suicide, but instead I left the convent. Can I ever forget that day? I stole some money, boarded a ship, and went to Paris. I found a job as a storekeeper's assistant, but it wasn't long after when I caught the eye of a handsome middle-aged Frenchman, Aubrey Dumont. He was a wealthy merchant of sorts, very charming. He had all the fascinations of a luring devil. He wanted something from me, and I was too needy to resist. I sold myself to him for 5,000 francs.
that was the beginning of greater sorrow and loneliness than I had ever known in the convent. But this time I saw no way out. The love that I had longed for all my life proved to be nothing more than a false and glorified notion of lust. A hideous monster disguised in the flattering garments of falsified wealth and enchanting witcheries. Though I didn't know it then, he had me shackled, hand and foot, mind, body, and spirit to the will of his own selfish and despicable pursuits. I was like a caged animal. I thought of getting back in the convent, and I thought of going back, but was so overcome by my shame and regret that I imagined she, in her spotless purity and grace, never again accept me for the blackened state into which I had fallen. Then I became pregnant.
Gave birth to a beautiful baby boy.
William.
Yes.
All my life I dreamed of having a child of my very own, and it was a glorious feeling indeed to at last experience the bliss of that sacred motherhood which I had once feared I might never know. But my fascination, the charming Audrey Dumont, did not share my sentiments regarding parental love and devotion, and he determined to take my William away from me and send him to a nearby abbey to be raised by the convent nuns. I was utterly horrified. He attempted to convince me that this course of action would be an advantage to both him and I, for I was only a girl, he said, and certainly far too inexperienced to properly mother a child. And he, a prominent businessman, was too closely occupied with his thriving business affairs to have anything to do with the responsibility of raising a son. But I stubbornly refused to obey him. He threatened to murder William, so I ran away. I believe you know the rest of the story.
I am so sorry for the pain that you have suffered.
May I ask, have you spoken to Sister Kate since you began working at the hospital?
I haven't spoken to her, but I've seen and felt enough to assure me that she wants absolutely nothing more to do with me.
But Collette, perhaps she doesn't recognize you.
Kate would know me instantly. I know she would. But I'm a fallen woman. Fallen from grace.
We are all fallen from grace.
Then I have fallen too far to be loved.
There is no sin too black, no fear too great, and no wall too high, which our Savior's love cannot overcome.
Miss Clayton, if you are feeling that it is too late for redemption, be assured it is never too late for Jesus.
To respond to your statement, allow me to enlighten you as to certain Magdalene laundries in Ireland that are run by the Sisters of Mercy. These are asylums reserved specifically for such fallen women and unmarried mothers as I. The nuns who pray to Jesus and his mother Mary are the same nuns who would snatch my child away from me and for the sin of fornication force years of miserable penance upon me. They also say God is love, but I do not wish to hold even the remotest connection with a religion that upholds self-imposed misery as the means of attaining acceptance in the sight of God. I've said enough. Good night, ladies.
Oh!
She has given up all hope. What can I do for her? Ellen, she's simply devastated. It seems as though she wants help from nobody. What can I do for her?
Sometimes the catalyst for emotional healing comes through acknowledging such pain.
How?
Because it can be the means through which we find belonging in the arms of Jesus.
But, Ellen, if she does not want to receive love, then how are we to give it to her?
Pray.
Pray?
That is the very best thing that we could ever do for her.
Yes. Yes. I suppose you're right. Ellen, it's late. I must go to bed now.
Good night, my dear. Oh, God. You alone are the hidden witness to this pain through history. And the witness who alone can bring restoration and healing to the children of John and Cassandra Darrington. I must speak to Mr. Darrington.
Oh, Miss Clayton! Miss Clayton, I've just had a terrible moment.
Come in. Good evening, Ellen.
Good evening, Mr. Duncan. Thank you.
Well, what can I do for you this evening?
I must speak to you on a subject that is of great urgency. It concerns Priscilla and two other young women that I believe you recently become acquainted with.
And who might that be?
Two young nurses. One is a European girl, the other is a nun, working at the hospital.
You mean Sister Kate? You know Sister Kate?
No, I only know of Sister Kate.
And what is it about Sister Kate that perks your interest? And by the way, what's the name of that invalid girl upstairs?
Her name is Collette, sir. She is the European girl that I referred to.
Remember now, is her health improving?
Mr. Dallington, before I say anything more, I must ask your permission to bring up your past.
My past? Why?
It concerns certain events that are transpiring within the lives of all of us at this very moment. I know that the remembrance of your past life brings with it the pain and the heartache of regret. But because of my conscience, I will not keep silent any longer.
That case, you can speak your mind.
It concerns your first wife, Miss Andrew Fletcher. Mr. Dallington, I believe that God works out his sovereign will even through the greatest mistakes of human weakness. I know that you are loath to unearth the casket of this painful past, but if truth shall be known, then you must submit to it.
What do you know of my past?
Forgive me, sir, but have you forgotten that I was the midwife who delivered yours and Cassandra's twin daughters?
I only have one daughter.
No one you have accepted. But, sir, you're not only unjust to Priscilla, but to two other young women. I beseech you, have you only one daughter?
I only know one daughter.
And what about her two sisters?
That is not my concern.
Mr. Dallington, does Priscilla not deserve to know the truth? And should she not hear it from the lips of the one man whom she loves and admires above any living mortal?
It is painful enough to remember these things. But how can you impose on my unwillingness the unnecessary obligation to disclose to my daughter that thing that would only corrupt her innocence and upset her current happiness?
But how can a true confession upset or corrupt anything? Though it may be uncomfortable, sins of sexual immorality and deception within a generation must be confessed and forsaken. And then, and only then, can the curse be broken and healing restored.
Ellen, your speech is eloquent indeed, but it is completely irrational in my case.
Do you mock me, sir? Allow me to remind you that the path of duty often leads us through the valley of the shadow of death.
What right do you have to question the execution of my duty?
Cassandra is gone! Mine is the only voice left that may speak on behalf of her children.
No! Priscilla must never know the shame that her mother brought on this family.
Mr. Downton, I understand that you have experienced great devastation. But if God's grace cannot reconcile the past with our future, then why should we trust that his ways are higher than ours?
Ellen, what do you hope to gain by coming here tonight?
Do you know where Priscilla's twin sister is, Cassandra Kate? That child is not only motherless, she is fatherless.
She's not my child anymore. She belongs to the sisters.
Does that matter? And what about Cassandra's illegitimate child?
That devil, Jeffrey Clayton, can take care of his own child.
The child was a girl.
And how would you know?
Before she died, your wife Cassandra named the child Collette Clayton.
How would you know?
I was with Cassandra the night she gave birth to the child.
Well, the fact that this is of no significance to
me. Mr. Dallington, do you realize what you're saying?
What I realize is the woman that I love betrayed me for my one-time friend. That child is not my responsibility.
I know that child is not your responsibility. But would you have me to believe that because of a very great wrong done to you long ago, you would spend the remainder of your life harboring bitterness and prejudice against two innocent children?
I never said that.
Then where is your compassion? Mr. Dallington, God Almighty is witness to the painful truth that you have all these years endeavored to keep hidden from the world.
That busy enough.
But will you reconcile with Priscilla's twin sister, Cassandra Kate, the child that you disown? Has it ever occurred to you, sir, that that child may be facing alone the trials and the confusions of a life without hope and without family?
I said that was enough! You will never bring this subject up again with me. Your lack of discretion and respect in this matter has greatly weakened your influence with me. You may retire for the night.
Good night, then.
Good night! Oh, the insolence! Oh, Cassandra. Oh, it's true. I crushed her already broken soul when I rejected her. It is painfully true that my self-righteous conduct offered little or no protection against the seductions of that Jeffrey Clayton. She was so young. She was so naive. And to forget it, it's impossible. Oh, God. All thy waves and thy billows have washed over me.
I'll deliver these letters to the doctor now. child. Are you looking for someone?
Yes, I am looking for a Miss Kate Fletcher. Do you know where I might find her?
Well, there's no one here of that name, I'm afraid.
Oh, well, then perhaps you know a Sister Kate.
Yes, Sister Kate. She is here. She stepped out for a moment, but she'll return shortly. Would you care to take a seat?
Oh, yes. Thank you.
There's a young lady here to see you, Sister Kate.
Oh, tell whoever it is. I can't possibly see anyone right now. Far too busy with all of
you. Excuse me? This is the young lady.
Sister Kate, I believe we have met before. Why, yes, I do believe I've seen you before. Please, would you be so kind as to step aside for a moment? I have something that I must speak to you privately about. Yes, you may. I know this visit must seem very strange to you, but I can assure you I come on a very urgent errand, and it is to summon you to the bedside of a very ill woman. The woman that you know as Collette Clayton. The father confessor is the one that Miss Clayton ought to see. I'm sorry, Miss Gallington, but I can do nothing to avert the pain or the worries of that woman. But Collette has asked to see you, not the father confessor.
Why?
She fain would bring her gift to the altar, but for the remembrance that there is still a seed of bitterness between you and her.
Is she really that desperate?
She contacted typhoid fever while working here at the hospital. We fear she may not recover. For the past 3 weeks, she has been in a restless and increasingly life-threatening condition. And yet, even when she is plunged into a delirious and unconscious state, she does not cease to murmur your name or call out for you to come to her. Sister Kate, I know that there is both love and pity in your heart for Collette. Please, for the love of God, come with me to see her.
No, you don't understand, Miss Gallington. Collette Clayton is dead to me.
Oh, Sister Kate, I implore you, do not hold against Collette the hurts of a past life. She is desperate to see you.
Where is Collette staying?
At my father's house on the outskirts of town. My carriage could take us there. Will you come?
I will inform the head nurse of my absence. Wait for me here. Sister Bernice, a matter of urgency, I must step out for a while. Please excuse me.
Very well.
I cannot be gone long. My ship sails for Europe this afternoon.
Then let us hurry. We don't have much time.
Jesus. He spoke to my
my heart, Kate, and I knew it was him. I'm very glad for you, truly I am. And I found you, my sister, again. Colette, I must ask your forgiveness. When you came to the hospital, you felt condemnation and rejection. And for that, I'm so sorry. I've already forgiven you, Kate. I don't deserve it. I love you. I don't deserve it. No matter how hard I try, every day I strive for perfection and I still feel unacceptable. I feel just like you. I was that woman caught in adultery. But Jesus lifted me from the dust. He told me that he loved me and said only go and sin no more. Oh, Kate, now I know why he didn't cast a stone at that woman. I know because he didn't cast a stone at me either. Now, have you found your heart's desire?
It's coming, I know it is.
You said the same thing 5 years ago.
No.
How much longer will you wait? You know, I had a dream last night. I dreamt that you met your birth father. Do you still cherish that childhood dream of one day finding you?
I gave that up long ago. Besides, I'm going back to Ireland.
Would you consider staying in America with William and I?
No, it's impossible. Colette, I must go. There's nothing here for me.
How do you know this is God's will for your life?
Why are you always full of these questions?
Do you feel that inner peace that you once spoke of?
Inner peace? It's been like a phantom, fading me at every turn.
Then why are you going back?
Because I believe that even if I cannot find peace for myself, I will become the spiritual mother of souls. Thousands of souls could be lost if I neglected my duty to plead and suffer on their behalf.
But you don't need to be in the walls of a monastery to intercede for others. Kate, nothing you will ever do will earn your acceptance in the sight of God.
Colette, you don't understand the guilt that haunts me simply because I feel I can never do enough good.
We all have sinned and fallen short of the glory of God. Kate, has the spirit of religion obscured your vision of truth? Don't dismiss the voice of Christ because the love of others drowns out the gentle calling of his Holy Spirit.
I pray about these things. I promise to continue to pray. God will show me what his will is.
Yes, he will, in his time.
You can get all better, Mama. Would you like a peppermint for Duck to hold?
Why, thank you, Doug.
Morning, ladies.
Morning, Doctor.
How are you feeling, Miss Clayton?
Well, a bit tired, but a lot better, thank you.
I already checked it, Dr. Hall. My mother's gonna be all better.
You're absolutely correct, old Master Clayton. You're gonna be a doctor someday. Helen, just make sure to keep up with the regular medicine. I'll be back tomorrow to check on her.
Yes, thank you, Doctor.
Let me wish you a good day.
Thank you.
Would you like a peppermint from Dr. Hall?
Thank you.
To every purpose.
Katie. I must ask you forgiveness. Forgiveness for the way that I've hurt you. I know that I've hurt you deeply, and I'm so sorry. Can you forgive me? Yes, I forgive you. Of course I forgive you. Now, Colette, you will get well again. I know you will. You must.
I already feel better now that you're here.
Kate, I've found what I've been seeking all my life.
Is it your birth father?
Someone far more precious. The one King David called the father of the fatherless. Kate, it's Jesus. He spoke to my heart and I knew it was him.
So happy for you, Colette. I truly am. And I found you, my sister, again.
Colette, I'm sorry for the pain that I have caused you. When you came to the hospital, you felt condemnation and rejection. And for that, I'm so sorry. I was wrong to despise you as I did.
I have already forgiven you, Kate. I love you.
I don't deserve it. You know, every day since you left, I have striven for perfection. And still, I feel desperately unacceptable.
I felt just like you.
I was that woman caught in adultery. But Jesus, he lifted me from the dust. He told me that he loved me and said only go and sin no more. Now I know why he didn't cast a stone at that woman. I know because he didn't cast a stone at me either. Now, have you found your heart's desire yet?
It's coming, I know it is.
You said the same thing 5 years ago.
I know I did.
How much longer will you wait? You know, I had a dream last night. I dreamt that you met your birth father. Do you still cherish that child and dream of one day finding him?
No. No, I gave that dream up long ago. Besides, I'm going back to Ireland.
Would you consider staying in America with Willie and I?
No, Colette, please do not ask me. It's impossible. I must go. There's nothing here for me.
How do you know that this is God's will for your life?
Why do you always have to be so full of these questions?
Do you feel that inner peace that you once spoke of?
Inner peace? I confess it's been like a phantom, evading me at every turn.
Then why are you going back?
Because I believe that even if I cannot find peace for myself, I will become the spiritual mother of souls. Connett, if I didn't go back to Ireland, there'd simply be no place else fitting for me. Thousands of souls could be lost if I neglected my duty to plead and suffer on their behalf.
But you don't need to be in the walls of a monastery to intercede for others.
Kate,
nothing you ever will do will earn your acceptance in the sight of God.
Colette, you don't understand the guilt that haunts me simply because I feel I can never do enough good.
We all have sinned and fallen short of the glory of God. Kate, has the spirit of religion obscured your vision of truth? Don't dismiss the voice of Christ because the love of others drowns out the gentle calling of his Holy Spirit.
I have prayed both these things, Colette.
I promise I will continue to pray. God will show me what his will is.
Yes, he will. In his time. Thank you, darling.
Well, top of the morning to you, ladies. How are you feeling today, Miss Clayton?
A bit tired, Doctor, but a lot better, thank you.
And
right you are, young Master Clayton. You're going to make a fine doctor someday. Ellen, please continue to administer her medicine.
Yes.
I'll be back to check on her tomorrow morning.
Thank you, Doctor. Thank you.
Oh,
because I did, thank you.
Colette and I were just discussing the possibility of going for a ride once her strength was returned. At the rate she's progressing, she may be well enough to go riding by next week.
What? Oh, excuse me, sir, that belongs to me.
Where did you get this?
It was given to me.
Who gave it to you?
It was my mother's wedding ring. On her deathbed, she instructed the midwife it was to be mine.
Your mother gave this to you?
Yes.
God, is this why you spared me death?
Papa, whatever is the matter?
Priscilla, you can have no idea. Colette, I knew your mother.
You knew my mother?
Yes.
What do you mean, sir?
Papa, is there some sort of secret behind Colette's ring?
The hidden witness of the Holy Spirit will not keep silent. And I can hide nothing from the old God. Ladies, we need to sit down. Colette, I don't know how to tell you this, but your mother was my wife.
My mother was your wife?
Yes.
All my life I've been in search of the man who gave this ring to her.
And I am he.
Then you're my father.
No, no, I'm not. But I know who is.
Where is he? Do you know?
No, nor do I intend to find out.
Why?
Because he's a reprobate.
My father a reprobate?
He was a one-time friend of mine who deceived me in order to seduce my wife.
Papa, whatever do you mean?
Oh, Priscilla, I told you could have no idea. Mary Schuyler Gallington was my second wife.
You mean you were remarried? Papa, why did you never tell me this?
Didn't I tell you? Because I didn't want you to be concerned with the affairs of my past.
But I don't even know who my real mother is.
You divorced your mother.
Who was she?
Oh, Cassandra. She was the better of my heart.
But you divorced her, Papa. Why?
She became pregnant by another man. She bore Jeffrey Clayton's child.
But where is my true mother?
After divorcing your mother, I sent her away to live in the Magdalena Laundries. That asylum in Ireland reserved for fallen women. It's run by the Sisters of Mercy. Shortly after that, I met a young widow, Mary Schuyler. 2 months after we were married, we received word that Ellen Cassandra had died giving birth to a little girl.
I have a sister, and you never told me? Why?
For the same reason I never told you that Mary Schuyler wasn't your real mother.
But I have a sister. Where is she?
Oh, sweetheart. Sweetheart, this little... So little, this woman... is your sister. Consider her request. I justified myself by saying that I was dead to my past, that I was starting a new life with a new wife who knew nothing then except that. Well, I had a child from a deceased wife.
What did Ellen do then?
Shortly after Mary and I were married, we moved to the United States, and I convinced Ellen to leave Cassandra's children in the care of the Sisters of Mercy and to come with us. It was only because Ellen was unwed that she couldn't support herself and 2 young girls that she finally agreed to come. She was never the same cheerful Ellen I once knew. And as for me, I've been haunted daily by the knowledge that I had failed in my moral obligation to 2 fatherless girls who were left alone in a world of heartless strangers.
Excuse me, sir. The initials on this ring?
CFD?
Yes.
Cassandra Fletcher Dellington.
I know I'm one of the girls that you speak of, but you keep saying there were 2 girls.
I have another sister?
Yes, Cassandra. Sweetheart. You were born a twin.
What? Papa, what was her name?
We named her after your mother, Cassandra Kate. She was to keep your mother's maiden name.
Fletcher.
Yes.
Priscilla, it's Sister Kate's full name. Sister Kate did not, she's her twin. Oh, Papa, is this really true? Why have you kept this thing hidden from me for so long?
Why did I keep it from you? Don't you understand? What could the knowledge of this shameful history do for you?
All my life I have been believing a lie.
I just wanted to shield you from the shame.
Shield me from the shame? Papa,
so sorry. I should have told you years ago. But sometimes there's a hidden truth inside every man that can only be revealed in God's precious timing. Collette, would you sit with me for a while, please? Collette, I'm so sorry. I failed to show compassion to you at a time when you're helpless. Would you give me this opportunity to make it right with you, to accept you into my household as my daughter?
Collette, you will say yes.
I only receive it as from a father.
That's what I've always dreamed of. Thank you.
Impossible. She'd never understand, and she'd certainly never come back with me.
That is being so unfair. You cannot say that God is not calling Kate at this very moment.
Priscilla, please.
Kate said herself that there was nothing here for her. She needs to know. And Papa,
remember, you once told me that it is sometimes only through suffering and heartache that we can truly experience the power of God's grace.
Here's the name and location of the monastery where Kate may be found. And take this with you. Kate will know it.
Please, girls, just leave me alone with my thoughts. Please. It's true you're the daughter I abandoned over 20 years ago. I felt I couldn't accept you as my child because you bore your mother's name. The pain she caused me became greater every time I thought of taking you back as my child. She was unfaithful to me. She was my best friend. I loved her dearly, but I couldn't bring myself to forgive her. I wanted to punish her, and I did that through you.
But Papa,
I'm so sorry I abandoned you. And I know there's nothing I could ever say or do that would ever make it up to you. Your sisters want you home. And daughter, I want you home. And I want to be that father you should have had. Oh, God, I've come to the end of myself.
My grace is sufficient for you, for my strength is made perfect in weakness.
But I abandoned my own child, my Cassandra Kate. No, I can never expect her to forgive me for what I've done.
Fear not. I shall turn the hearts of the fathers to the children, and the hearts of the children to their fathers.
Surely the nuns would turn me away at the monastery. And even if I could find Kate, why would she even forgive me?
I will go before you and make the crooked places straight. I will break in pieces the gates of brass and cut in sunder the bars of iron.
I do know a ship sailing for Europe this morning. Yes, I will go. I will go immediately.
Thank you.
supposed to deny their existence.
Hey, I'm hungry. So hungry. Do you hear me?
Yes, Colette. I too am hungry. So hungry. Oh, God. Please, help me.
Kate, beloved.
Who is it? Who's there?
I am Yahweh, your Redeemer. Daughter, I say unto you, arise. Behold, I stand at the door and knock. There is only one thing that I desire.
Only one thing? But Lord, I have given up everything in order to serve you. Don't you see my acts of service and sacrifice? Aren't these enough?
My daughter, you are troubled about many things.
It's true. I am desperately searching for peace and for assurance.
I am your peace, my precious daughter. Are you weary and heavy laden?
I am weary, very, very weary. I find myself wishing for things I cannot have, for a life I cannot live. These voices in my head, they give me no rest.
My child, come to me, and I will give you rest.
Lord, I don't know why, but all my life, I have felt abandoned and unloved.
Will you trust me?
I want to trust you, please. God, show me how I can trust you more.
I have loved you with an everlasting love, my daughter. I have made you and fashioned you. What is keeping you from accepting the work of my hands?
If only I knew that I belonged.
I have been witness to the thoughts and feelings of your heart, my child. Only delight in me, and I will give you the desires of your heart.
What must I do?
My child, will you make your heart the place of my rest?
My heart? Only my heart?
It is the only one thing I desire. Will you forsake everything and follow me? Will you forsake it all for my sake?
Thank you.
Behold, I will do a new thing. Now it shall spring forth. Shall you not know it? I will be the father of the fatherless, and will set the lonely.
Your heart is open wide. You long for what I bring. I pray somehow.